place where we can find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Take me in with your arms spread wide. Take me in like an orphan child. Never let go. Oh my God, to find I am overwhelmed with the joy divine. Love like this sets our hearts on fire. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. Resurrection song. This is my hallelujah come. This is why it's to you I run. Oh, there's no space that His love can reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace.
Hi guys, I'm Rachel and I'm from the Sophomore Girls. So I know you guys are probably wondering why everything looks like a jungle in here, and I promise we're not obsessed with Tarzan. The jungle is meant to represent something. Think about what happens in a jungle. Trees outgrowing trees and all types of animals. It's pretty chaotic, untamed, and crazy. In a similar way, our identities are the same. In our world, there's people trying to be better than others, putting others down, and the constant worry of what people are saying about you. It's just as chaotic as a jungle. I know my life at times has felt just like a jungle. So many different things competing inside of me. I've had times where others put me down just to make them look better, and it's not fun. Something I'm struggling with is not changing myself to fit in with others. Having that constant thought that someone is judging me, it's just a battle I fight every day. But maybe I'm not alone. Maybe there are people that struggle with the same thing. Maybe there are those of us who could agree that our identity feels as confusing, untamed, and crazy as a jungle. Maybe tonight God wants you to show you who He wants you to be. That is what our message is about tonight. Being who God wants us to be and not what others want us to be. We're going to have some students come up on stage and tell you their stories and situations. They're going to tell you how they handled the situations and some tips and tricks that may also help you guys. Now I'm going to introduce Judah to share his message.
That I'm supposed to be discussing with you guys is acknowledging and explaining to you what holds us back from God and securing our identity and our faith in Him. I'm going to build off of Carly's and Brian's Q&A. So, sin is the thing holding us back from God. To describe you and tell you what sin is, in my opinion, is the enemy's dialect. Basically, it's his speech, it's his language to taint, deceive, destroy, and influence us, and destroy us, basically. Using that dialect, he persuades you to not love. That sounds overly simple, but that's the best way to describe it, not loving. And that's the best way to describe the complete opposite of what God does, not loving. If you want to open your Bibles up to John 8:1 to 8:8, we're going to talk about the story when Jesus was teaching in the temple and the... when a woman was caught in adultery. So, Jesus went to the Mount of Olives early in the morning and came again to the temple. All the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. The scribes and Pharisees brought a woman that had been caught in the act of adultery and placing her in the midst. They said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now in the law of Moses commands us to stone her." "So what do you say?" They said to test him. I want to also tell you guys, this was a big test for God, because I'll explain that later. So now the law, yeah. This they said to him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and wrote in his finger on the ground. And as they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, "Let who has without sin among you be the first to throw the stone." And once more, he bent down and wrote on the ground. And one by one, each Pharisee, starting with the older ones, left. And all was left but Jesus with the woman. Jesus stood up and said to her, "Woman, where are your prosecutors?" She said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Now, I want to outline how much forgiveness is portrayed in the story. Adultery, then, was, you were dead. You're screwed. I wanted to point that out. You're dead. I want to explain and give some content to what the Pharisees were trying to do and accomplish. Basically, it was a trap for Jesus. If Jesus gave mercy and love to the woman, the Pharisees would claim Jesus is not true to tradition, and he's lied to about his identity being Jesus Christ. Sorry if I'm tapping on my phone. If Jesus gave mercy and love to the woman, the Pharisees would claim he's untrue. If Jesus did not react with love and mercy, the Pharisees would claim he is unloving and therefore not true. Jesus completely baffles and embarrasses the Pharisees by taking the middle path. "Whoever has not sinned once shall throw the first stone." And one by one, the Pharisees left until it left him and the woman, showing us that all people sin, no matter how humble, merciful, and loving you are. Throughout Jesus' life, he showed us that there is an answer to sin, putting our trust and faith in his resurrection and believing and serving him throughout our lives. I want to ask you one question. Are you putting your faith, I want to ask you one question before I invite Alex up here. Are you putting your faith in God, and does it affect your identity? Thank you.
From the ninth grade boys. Tonight I'll be talking about anxiety, how to deal with it, and how to cure it. In my life, I struggle with social anxiety and still do. It's just something I've been trying to hide because certain people make fun of me for it. I didn't always used to be like this. In fact, before quarantine, I was almost an extrovert and was really competitive in most things. But since quarantine, I turned into a bat stuck in its cave, waiting for life to change something for me when I used to chase my goals and change that outcome. When we experience anxiety, we run to non-God-related things, such as video games, sports, music, and for me, it's pushing myself to work out harder to have a better outside image. This is a way we try to fill the void, and how I've tried to fill the void, whether it's with listening to music or trying to accomplish another goal. In some way, we try and do things on our own to ease our anxiety or stress. The cure for anxiety. There's a cure for anxiety, and that is a loving, authentic community. In 1 John 4, verse 18, it says, "Perfect love casts out all fear. It also casts out anxiety, stress, and depression." The Bible has so many examples of community and why it's important, such as this verse, 1 John 4:11. "Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another." This is just a prime example of authentic community. And we can eliminate anxiety about anything, whether it's homework, home life, or just simple things like, who am I going to spend time with today? So to recap, the cure to anxiety is love in an authentic community. What steps can we take towards community? So taking off what I said previously, authentic community is composed of people that love one another unconditionally. What unconditional love is it's just loving someone or something, whether they did good or bad, right or wrong. I still have to work on this myself as I grow to be a better person. We still love them because God loves them also. In Philippians 2, 3 through 4, it says, "In humility, value others above yourselves." This is a great example of unconditional love and how we can love others in a way that builds them up and makes them progress faster to become a better interactive person. Oftentimes, we choose to judge others just because of their looks or what they do and only focus on the bad side of them. That destroys authentic community because when we judge someone off of outer appearances, we aren't loving them. We often take the phrase, "Don't judge a book by its cover," for granted. I've been a victim to doing this. And it's something we can all work on as we're trying to develop better friendships and communities. So the next time you see someone at your school or in town that you know is picked on for the way they look, just remember you can make a difference by presuming the best of them and saying hi or ask how their day is going. So to wrap things up, I have a question for you guys. How can you make better authentic relationships with people? And remember that love in an authentic community cures anxiety, fear, and anything else that stands in your way. I challenge you guys this week to create a more authentic relationship with someone in your life and choose to love them instead of being judgmental. Thank you.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I may make, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, your darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I can able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. My life laid down, surrender.
running after me. With my life laid down, surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Everybody, how are we doing? All right, that's great to hear. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Carly Dabbs, and we're gonna be doing, oh yeah, ninth grade girls, what's up? Yeah. All right, so we're gonna do a Q&A, and I have two amazing hub group leaders up with me. Let's give them a round of applause. Okay, I'm gonna have them introduce themselves, so I'll hand it over to Janelle first.
Hi everybody, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Janelle Saylor. I am one of the hub group leaders for freshman girls. This is my first year actually helping out with youth group, and I'm absolutely loving it so much. I know I'm here to lead the girls, but I find every week I'm learning stuff from them as well. So, love being here.
My name is Ethan Churchill. I'm with the ninth grade boys. This is also my first year leading, and I just graduated from Atascadero High School last year, so hoping to keep going here for a couple years.
All right, so let's get right into it. So my first question is gonna go to Janelle. So what does identity mean to you?
So your identity is basically who you are, who the facts and the qualities and just who you are, basically what makes you you compared to anybody else.
All right, we're going to jump into the next question. Thank you for your answer. So this is going to go to Ethan. What are examples of where people can place their identity?
People can place their identity in almost anything. Nowadays, it's social media, sports, what you own. It can be really anything that you value and you attribute to yourself.
Thank you. So our third question. If somebody who doesn't know you sees your life, what would they say your identity is? And this is for both of you.
If somebody didn't know me and they were looking, they would probably first just kind of see the basics. I'm a wife. I'm a new mom. I'm a daughter, a sister, a teacher, a friend, a coworker. Hopefully they would think that I'm kind. I've been told I smile a lot and I'm very short. Yeah, I think that's.
I am also short, but I'm very active in sports and I go out, play a lot of different sports in our community. But I like basically pretty general things, but hopefully people can see that I come to church because I try to be a big part of the community here, and I love volunteering and stuff like that, so hopefully people see that in me when I'm not at church.
Thank you for your answers. So keeping this next, like keeping your response in mind, is there more to your identity than this, and what would that be?
Yes, and I think for me, it kind of depends on like the situation that I'm in, but in all honesty, I'm not sure everyone, especially in like my work life, would necessarily know that I'm a Christian. I think they would all say that I'm a good person, that I'm nice and kind, but I'm not necessarily sure that they could explicitly say that I am a follower of Christ. So that obviously is something I need to work on and change.
For me, it's I really like my friends, and I really like that friend group. And my identity normally lies in them. Like, when I'm around them, all I want to do is just, like, stay around them. Whenever I'm, like, not with them, I'm, like, distant from other people, or I act like, oh, I already have a friend group, like, I don't really need to hang out with anybody else. So that's something I can work on and, like, grow in as I go on in my life.
Thank you. Those were very honest answers. So Ephesians 4:30 says, remember, God has identified you as his own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. Does this verse move you at all to change where your identity is placed and how?
Hearing that verse, I think when God says he owns, like, I'm his, it it's really empowering, because you think about, like, every day you can go your whole day and nobody really talks to you, nobody really, like, cares. But when you really think about it, it's like God made you for a reason. You have a purpose. And every day you live, you have purpose and you have reason. And a lot of people forget that and they feel lost in their lives. But, like, when it really comes down to it, no day is a wasted day. And God has a plan for you, and he's your king and your father and creator.
Can I read the verse again? When I hear this verse, I think about this verse, and it says, he has identified you as your own. My mind automatically goes to another passage in Romans 8 that talks about when we've been saved, we've been adopted as sons and daughters into God's family, which is pretty crazy when you think about it, that the creator of the universe has chosen me to be a part of his family. And I don't know about you guys, but I know for me growing up, my identity especially was as my family. I got all the time, oh, you're Jim and Julie's daughter, or my favorite, you're Jamie's little sister. If you're a young sibling, you might get that. It's annoying after a while. But your identity, who you are, is like in direct relationship to your family. Maybe you have family traits, you have certain things that your family does, and that's kind of how people know you. And so when I think about God has adopted me as part of his family, then everything that I am doing in my life should be a direct reflection of him and what he has called us to do. And really realizing that I am a sinner and I don't deserve salvation at all, but he has given it to me. And so what I should be spending my entire life here on earth is pointing people back to him and giving him the glory and really finding my identity in him and what he has called me to do, and not the things of this world that are very tempting, or to be selfish, or to do what necessarily I want to do because it's what everybody else is doing. So I think kind of having that mindset of I am a daughter of God, that kind of like shocks me into, oh shoot, like what am I doing with that knowledge, and how am I using that to further the kingdom of God?
Those are very deep answers. So, wow. Thank you. So our very last question for this Q&A is, being completely transparent, what does your current lifestyle say about your identity?
My current lifestyle is I'm working full time. I'm going to college And a lot of times I act like I'm too busy or I'm too tired to be like the best I can be. And I use that as an excuse sometimes, and it doesn't look good. Like it's a look I don't want and I need to change. But in the future, like, I can definitely work on this. There's nothing, like, that's being tired and being busy is like the oldest excuse in the book. And I think in the future it just needs like change in my life. But I'm working on it, so.
I was thinking about how do I identify what my identity is, and I think it's a direct correlation with whatever your current identity is in the thing or your hobby or whatever it is that you spend the most time doing. Wherever you put your time and your effort, and that's kind of where you're placing your identity. And for me personally, before going on maternity leave, I don't know where the little one is, but for me, it was definitely my job. I'm a middle school science teacher, and if you catch me even outside of my normal working hours, I'm doing work, I'm grading papers, I'm planning lessons, I'm thinking, and it will take me away from building relationships with others, or in the past it has kept me from volunteering at a youth group, or because I'm so focused on that. And I'm not saying that it's wrong or it's bad to want to do your job well, whether you're a student or you have a job. But I think when we come to make that our main focus in life is my job, why? I find myself more concerned about what others think of me when I'm doing my job, whether it's my students thinking I'm a good teacher, my coworkers, the kinds of lessons that I'm planning, whatever it is, I find myself being more concerned about what others think of me than what God thinks of me instead. And so it's definitely something that I need to work on in order to find that balance of using my skills and still doing a good job, because that's what God has stewarded me to do, but not finding my identity in that. And that's hard. It's a struggle and definitely something that I'm still working on.
Well, thank you both again. Can we get a round of applause for these amazing leaders? So I want to say thank you to you guys for being here tonight and just learning and having so much fun. So thank you again.
What's up, you guys? My name is Brian Gray. I am from the Freshman Boys. And I'll be giving the last message of the night. So about a year ago at March Madness, I gave a message on stress and how we all have to deal with it and we go through it. And so this year, I kind of thought of the same idea. I was thinking I need to find something that everybody goes through. So this time I chose anxieties insecurities. Goodness, that's what I did last year. Because I know that everybody goes through those. So I've been very blessed not to go through too many insecurities. But a couple that come to mind from the past were in elementary, I used to think my face was too round, which is funny now. I used to, in middle school, think that glasses were for nerds, which clearly I'm wearing them now, so I guess I'm a nerd. But I used to think I was too short, and I thought it was funny that Ethan said that he thought he was too short because he's like 6 foot, so the guy's lying. But but that's the point I'm trying to get at, is that I'm cool with saying I'm short because I've given it to God, you guys. And honestly, if I didn't give it to God, I think I'd still be worrying about it just standing up here. Like, the stand is shorter than, like, the stand would have been up here if I wasn't this tall. So yeah, just to put that out there. But a couple of verses that moved me about different things like insecurities was Psalms 55:22, which says, cast your cares in the Lord and he will sustain you. And Matthew 6:27 says, who of you by worrying can add a single hour to your life? I like these both because they're very to the point, and they're just saying, we can't worry, you guys. We have to give it to God because that's what he wants us to do. And if we keep worrying about it, it's just going to pull us down. I listened to a rapper named NF, and a lot of you might as well. He made a song called Drifting, and in that song he put, look into the mirror and tell yourself I love you, or convince yourself that no one in this world would ever want you. And like the verses from the Bible that I just read, it's very down to the point, and it's just given to us straight that we can either make the choice of letting insecurities pull ourselves down and go down a path of thinking that we're not enough, or giving it to God and believing that we are enough, and that's how he made us to be in this moment. So imagine if just one hub group this year decided to give their insecurities to God, how different that would look for us. They would be acting like they don't care what people think of us, because it'd be true. And they would be not worrying about a single thing they did because they know that God loves them. So I challenge you guys tonight that you give your insecurities to Christ and that you stop worrying about those things, because in the long run, it's not worth it, I promise you. Thank you guys so much.
You guys can stay seated for this one. You sit up enough.
Oh,
all the money that the world could hold. Mountains made of solid gold. Riches that could buy my dreams. You are better than all these things. The prettiest face to turn their eyes. Beauty that could hypnotize. The open doors that looks may bring. You are better than all these things. Your love is better than life. You are the well that won't run dry. And I have tasted and I have seen. You are better than all these things. Being liked and loved by everyone. Approval that outshines the sun. Cheered by all who think of me. You are better than all these things. Your love is better than life. You are the well that won't run dry. And I have tasted and I have seen. You are better than all these things. You are better than all these.
Tonight you guys have recognized that you are a child of God and you are loved by Him and called to love others. It is incredible to see the transparency of our speakers tonight. I hope their openness created a space for you to think about what you are struggling with and maybe process with an authentic community, just like Alex said. Our lives are still going to be chaotic and crazy, just like the jungle behind me. The truth of the matter is, what are we going to do when we hit those anxious moments? Are we prepared to go to God in those moments of anxiousness? The main takeaway is that you guys know God is with you. He loves you, even through those struggles. He wants to know that you guys are not alone, and you guys aren't the only ones struggling with those trials. So I'm going to close with a prayer and then invite the juniors up here. God, I just wanted to thank you for bringing us here tonight and for providing us a space to be able to worship and praise you. Thank you for an amazing opportunity and for all the fun things we got to do tonight. I pray that you spoke through not only me, but the people who have shared tonight. We love you, we praise you, in your name we pray, amen.
What up, what up? Did you guys have a fun night tonight? If you didn't, make some noise, please. Awesome. I had an absolute blast between all the activities, skate park, dodgeball, open cafe, Nine Square, and the art room. I just want to acknowledge the team that put it together real fast. So when I acknowledge them, make sure you guys make some noise so they feel your appreciation. We have a student leadership team called Salt and Light. What it represents is student leadership is like people that actually want to take ownership within the ministry and actually say, hey, I don't want to just attend church, but I want to be the church. And I challenge every single one of you, if you are coming to ABC's youth group on a regular, I challenge you maybe to make that next step of joining Salt and Light. We're going to be restarting it in the fall, and if you want to be able to help plan these nights and what they're looking like, please keep that in the back of your mind as we go into fall of 21 to 22. That said, the 9th and 10th grade Salt and Light has been working for about 3 months to pull off this night. And as you can see, there's an incredible set behind me. There's incredible games outside. So can you guys give it up? Massive shout out to the 9th and 10th Salt and Light. In addition, I just want to specifically just honor our speakers of the night. That is terrifying to come up here in front of 200 students. So give shout outs for all our speakers. Well done, well done. And then of course, Eowyn and Judah and Ricky for slaying it on the instruments. That was awesome. And of course, our tech people in the back who did all that light show and slides, make some love for them. And then the guy who is in charge of it all, forming the committee to actually pull off this night, Logan Williams, our intern. Give him some massive, massive love. Logan, I heard a shriek. That is good for you. Lots of love coming your way. Before we go into inviting up our last little bit of the night, couple reminders for you guys. One, just for everyone here, if you brought trash into this worship center, we want to make sure we keep this place clean. So if you guys can help us out, as you're walking out, don't just take your trash, but look down the aisle, help us out, grab the trash next to you. We're not out just yet, so you don't have to like be moving just right now. And then addition to that, our Salt and Light 9th and 10th graders, we have an after party for you guys as soon as we finish cleaning up all our activities. So the sooner Salt and Light you guys help us clean up, put everything away, including all this, we have our after party for you in the cafe. So hang tight and we'll be getting that ready for you guys. Before we close out though, I want to invite our juniors who are planning next week. Give it up for, next week. We got one more of these. Give it up for Haley Farrell and McKenna Smith.
Hi guys, my name's Kenna.
I'm Haley.
And next week, our junior night is called Impressionable Reputations. We are going to have dinner, games, and make sure you come hungry, ready to play, and bring a new friend.
If you guys bring a new friend next week to youth group, you guys will be entered in with additional raffle tickets to win prizes, along with other opportunities to win cool items for your team huddles.
And lastly, we will have student messages and junior mentors in your team huddles.
Thank you. See you guys next week.
I just want to say thank you guys so much for coming. I know we had a blast setting this up for you guys. Did you guys have fun? I hope you guys walk away thinking about who God wants you to be and not what others want you to be. Just be who you want to be and who God wants to be. Thank you. See you guys next week.